Based in Los Angeles from 1929 until his untimely death in 1953, Lester Horton was often praised as one of the most powerful and innovative choreographers in America, or dismissed as a Martha Graham imitator. Many of his dancers gained international reputations, but the world knows little of the man who trained them. He built the first theater in America permanently devoted to the modern dance.
My name is Lalia Goldoni. In 1987, many of us who had been with Lester at dance theater had a reunion. It was here that my friend Alvin Ailey suggested I tell Lester's story. Most of us were just teenagers, rebellious and independent when we first came to dance theater. We were drawn by Lester from all parts of the city, Glendale, South Central, East LA, Hollywood, and Lester, who was like a father to us, turned us into a family, a splendid family of mavericks. He called us his kidlets.
We were touched by a very great man, by a genius named Lester Horton.
He, to this day, remains one of the strongest inventors of motion that it has ever been my pleasure to see, let alone work with.
Lester was a true teacher. There are people who just teach and there are teachers, you know, to masters.
The one thing that Lester strengthened above all else was our individuality, and it demanded it.
I hate the word genius, but I mean, you know, that's what he was, let's face it.
I remember a rehearsal of Another Touch of Clay, a Horton choreography based on the work of the Swiss painter. I was barely 15 then, waiting in the dark theater to rehearse with Carmen de Lavallade and Jimmy Truitt, when Lester came in and sat beside me. I felt his glance, that way he had of looking into you. I thought he wanted something from me. "You understand, don't you?" he said, almost without moving his lips. I was mute. Understand what? He smiled at the unspoken question on my lips and softly repeated himself, "I know you understand." That was his way, to see what was inside you, then teach you how to embrace it all. This was our dance theater. It opened in 1948, a converted machine shop next to a bar called the Golden Carp on the edge of Hollywood. It was our school, our stage, the laboratory of Lester's imagination, with its chocolate brown walls and the famous double red doors. Lester even designed the posters on the showcase. We were all different colors and backgrounds, Jew, Catholic, Baptist, gay, straight, Latin, black, white, oriental, integrated. We had so much regard for Lester, were so committed to the work, that it never even occurred to us.
You could have been purple with green polka dots and you could have come into this school. Race meant nothing because you could walk into the school and see every nationality in the world, but you never pictured it that way because you knew you had this freedom.
What was our ethnicity to this man but just another mask?
He was the only one in that day and age, I mean, that had complete desegregation and fought everybody, and everybody put him down for it.
And as I said, I went to see Eugene Loring, and we watched his class, two friends of mine and I. And he said, "Wait till class is over," and he said, "We'll go out for coffee." So we went out for coffee. And he said, "It's not that I don't want you in my class, but the parents or the students may object." And then he said, "But if you find a place on your side of town, I'll arrange my time to come over and teach you. And I won't tell you what we said after we left him."
At that time, a congressional committee was in town, investigating, labeling un-American activities. People who consorted with Negroes were likely to be fellow travelers, if not actually Reds, certainly Pinkos. Political speech was quite dangerous. We were known as the Silent Generation. But Lester's kidlets weren't silent. We were reckless, argumentative, sexy, dynamic, bound to dance theater, bound to our teacher, taking in everything like him, excluding nothing, as we ripened under the guidance of his relentless artistry. Lester considered everyone's contribution worthy. What we reflected back to him was his ideal world of total integration, total dedication, total theater. We were his kidlets. How can we begin to tell you what he meant to us?
The magician from Indiana, rumored to have Algonquin Indian blood flowing through his veins. A pioneer in American dance.
The first time I met his parents, I couldn't believe that this man had come out of this Grant Woodsian pair. They were a strange couple and didn't appear to me to have had the capacity to give birth to this man. It was, the mother hardly ever spoke, almost never smiled. She was the most dour creature that I have ever seen in my life, this straight-backed, careworn, sallow-complexioned woman with joyless expression forever from sun up to sundown. The father, on the other hand, I think all I can remember is, oh, there's a hole, let's stuff it with cement and rags.
Poor as they were, the family moved often, four times before Horton was 6 years old, but he always spoke fondly of the Indiana landscape and its effect on his work.
He was as much fun to travel with, Lelia, as he was to have make dances, because he was an amateur biologist. You know, it would be, we would be driving, Bill would usually drive at breakneck speed most of the time, and Newell and I would hang on in the back seat like this, and Lester in the front looking, always looking. Stop! A snake is shedding its skin. I'm sorry, I just saw Joshua Tree go by. I didn't see a snake shedding its skin. Back up, brakes went on, get out. There was a snake shedding its skin. He was a tremendously accurate observer of detail, of plant life. He could make anything grow, of zoological objects. He was sort of raw and self-tutored in many of these directions.
He belonged to a library nature study group which often visited the mysterious mounds near Anderson, built by a pre-Columbian culture known only as the Mound Builders. No one knew whether they were used for some forgotten ceremonial rite or as a place of burial, but their existence triggered his lifelong interest in the world of the American Indian. Years later, he created a ballet called The Mound Builders. He was fascinated by snakes, even thought of being a herpetologist. He haunted the Children's Museum in Indianapolis, studying tribal artifacts, because he knew the Indian had a similar regard for the serpent. At his eighth grade commencement, he was honored by being allowed to read his own composition, The Indian in His Native Art. When he was 16, he saw the Dennis Shawn dancers, and he was overwhelmed by the splendor of the costumes, this new kind of loose, flowing, barefoot dance. The next year, he saw Miss Ruth's Ishtar of the Seven Gates and Shawn's American Indian piece, The Feather of the Dawn. He began to study dance. In 1926, he gained his first and only patron, Clara Bates, the wealthy widow of an Indiana playwright. While he lived on her estate in the carriage house, she arranged to finance a music and drama pageant based on Longfellow's Song of Hiawatha. It toured all over Indiana and Ohio. Horton wrote, directed, designed the costumes, and played the title role himself. He was 19. Invited to Southern California, he gave six performances at the Argus Bowl, an outdoor theater in Eagle Rock, and discovered an oasis at the edge of one of the world's great deserts. In 1929, the City of the Angels, once an Aztec outpost, was already movie land, sleepy and surreal, a gateway to Polynesia with Spanish tile, tropical palms, Art Deco department stores, electric streetcars disappearing into orange groves. You had to cross a great desert to get here, whether by covered wagon, plane, train, or Model A Ford. People came with appetites and dreams. East Coast garment salesmen with ancestors in Poland and Russia. Midwestern dirt farmers. Real estate developers. Eccentrics. Dreamers. Cowboys. Mystics. They constructed a city. A kaleidoscope of fantasies. Of cultural fragments. Replicas of cultural fragments. Lotus Land. History was easily forgotten here. Horton, the explorer, saw a new frontier. He had studied briefly with Ted Shawn in Chicago. He'd seen Martha Graham, Doris Humphrey, and Charles Weidman. He was fascinated by Mary Wigmann's use of percussion, Ruth St. Denis's exoticism. Years later, his dancers saw him mock the pseudo-orientalism of the Dennis Shawn era with a little fragment he called Miss Ruth Hanging Out the Wash, replete with arm ripples and Hindu mudras. Though he was inspired by them all, he imitated none of them. His technique came out of a deep identification with the spirit of Native American ceremonial dance. In his own words, if dancers would make an effort to preserve this beauty which exists literally at our back door, something magnificent might be born. A dance can be built upon these art forms that would be truly representative of this great country, something new and fundamental. He remained in California, living on canned sardines in a converted chicken house on the Argus family land. For a year or so, he wandered up and down the Golden State, germinating those themes which would emerge as his life work. Then he began to teach.
Lester was quite an authority on Indian dancing. And so Miss Abel got with Lester and found a venue, so to speak, in the little theater of the Verdugos in Glendale, in the Verdugo Woodlands in Sycamore Park, which is across now from Glendale College. And so Lester decided to have a dance class, and away we went.
At the beginning, I always thought of him as a very sort of a panoramic dancer. And so I saw him in many dimensions at once. Because when we were together, he would be pounding, he would be drumming with his hands and with his feet, he would be acting with his body, he'd be talking a mile a minute, his face would be moving in all kinds of directions, he would be alternately furious and laughing and passionate, in sort of a passionate argument. He was always either trying to persuade me or persuade himself of an idea at a time, so that I'm thinking of him in many dimensions all at the same time.
His first students were not really dancers, but artists, actors, mask makers. Over the next 2 years, he choreographed several more pageants for them, and then...
Lester had read a book about Haiti, I think it was, so he created a voodoo dance. And it was the year of the Olympics in Los Angeles. And one of our friends, Wanda Grazer, who was quite an extraordinary woman, she was the secretary, and she thought, why don't we have an Olympic festival of the dance? And since she knew all of the dance teachers in Los Angeles, she put together this incredible program at the Philharmonic, and we played a whole week. Lester was able to rent Norma Gould's studio on Larchmont. And the thing that was interesting about that was that it was a very large and beautiful studio on Larchmont on the second floor. And and it was over a pet shop. And she had a big sign way up high on it. It said, Norma Gould, where women of culture send their children. Norma Gould dance studio, that is, where women of culture send their children. And then underneath was the sign for the pet shop, birds from all over the world. It was across from Balzer's grocery store.
Robert Lawrence Balzer, an ordained Buddhist monk who later was to virtually create the art of winemaking in California, and so an industry, remembers Horton vividly.
He was physically strong, mentally brilliant, totally dedicated to what he wanted to say and do and communicate.
We entered this studio. I now know where it was. At the time, I hadn't any idea that it belonged to Norma Gould, herself a legendary historical figure, Norma Gould's studio. And there was this class in progress with a mad percussionist, Bill Bowne,
who was playing the drums and the gongs and whatever. Lester had this remarkable collection, and Lester screaming at the top of his lungs, and a flowing assemblage of dancers doing progressions from one corner to the other, and I went, I'm in love.
Every class was new. There was, we hardly ever repeated anything as I look back on it. But he had a whole, one class I remember where we had to raise the arm from the shoulder. And then to raise it from the elbow, where the attention was on the elbow, and then on the wrist. And to be that aware of the fact that when you raised your arm, you were raising it from a particular place. It was raising the whole arm, but there was all the different emphasis, so that you became aware of all kinds of interesting things about your body.
There was very little going on at that point in whether your foot belonged to your ankle or not. I mean, there was very little emphasis placed upon anything kinetic as far as physiology is concerned. He might start a movement in the chest like this, and then he would add to it an arm movement, and then he would add to it a leg movement. Or if he were in another period where he wanted angularity, he would thrust a leg out and break it at that angle. It had nothing to do with how the leg moved. It had to do with how you carved movement out.
He's like a painter dancing at a painting, if you can understand what I'm trying to say. As a matter of fact, in a way, this is what this is the way I thought of him. That he would have been very much a painter who danced his ideas out on the floor or on the walls, because he used to throw himself back and forth and around. It was as though he was drawing the ideas on the walls with color and with shadow while we were listening to music or while we were discussing a drama.
If you danced with him, as I later did, your life was in danger. You never knew whether he would repeat something. If he had to take you by the hand or hold you or something, you were lucky if he did it twice the same way. He was a prolific inventor of motion, prolific. But if you didn't catch it right away, it would be gone and there'd be something else happening.
There's virtually no film record of Horton or his work in the 30s. He was changing so rapidly that he evidently never thought to fix what he was or what he did, because it would always be different tomorrow. The Great Depression, which hit after the stock market crash, seemed bottomless. Survival was a daily issue for everyone, including the newly formed Lester Horton Dance Group.
We had just no money. I remember that Ron Vandenberg had walked from Glendale to the studio, and by the time he got there, he was no good at all. He was completely worn out, you know, over to Larchmont in Beverly. But he didn't have any bus fare. It was really kind of astonishing how we managed. It really was.
Poverty wasn't the only issue of the day. There was labor violence, clashes between workers attempting to unionize, and management who used police, scabs, and thugs to break up their demonstrations.
By this time, I've already done some what we call at that period agitprop theater. Today you call it street theater. But in this period, because of the fact that we are being badgered by the police and almost every demonstration is broken up by the police, the only places where we can do demonstrations here were in the free speech zones, and there were only three free speech zones in L.A., the most important of which is in the plaza downtown. We used to do demonstrations there rather frequently. And the way we would do the theater is that we would usually manage to get a black van that was a closed-in van. And we would suddenly appear with this truck and van in the middle of a group of people and throw open the things. And then there were a couple of heads would appear, mainly Will Gear and me. And we would simply light up a flashlight underneath our faces as we came on, and then turned the flashlight off as we went off, which is our method of handling theater. You know, a face would appear out of the blackness, and the light thing would light up, and it would say a few lines, and then it would flash off and go off, and then the other person would speak. And so we would manage to get off maybe a scene and a half or two scenes of fairly telling dialogue, and then all of a sudden the cops would come riding in on horseback, flailing with their sticks on outside and breaking up the crowd and going in various directions. And so usually the talking heads would either manage to disappear in the van and the van would take off, or if the van couldn't take off, then Bill and I would slip into the crowd and usually make our way across the plaza to a Chinese place known as Jerry's Joint. And so I had general background stories of this nature, which he found interesting. And he found, he wanted to know, he wanted me to describe to him various types of activities, various types of struggles that had gone on in that period.
It was 1934, the first season of the Horton Dance Group. He would design numerous works about the human struggle against oppression, but that year, he created an amazing array of variations on ethnic themes: Chinese fantasy, Polynesian hand dance, Aztec ballet, Hebrew lament, 18 original ballets for the Shrine and Philharmonic auditoriums, to music by Bartok, Satie, Kodály, Maurice Ravel.
He was working on Ravel's Bolero at that point, and he needed multiple bodies because he started it as a color spectrum. So that he began with one single figure in silver and went through blues to end in crimson or carmine, so that the whole stage was really a wash with colors and dancers. I use the term dancers politely because some could dance and some could not dance. I had had no training with him, maybe three or four classes even, when he said, "Come be in Bolero." So I was in his so-called company, didn't have a formal one at that time. That was the mix of the Little Theater of the Verdugos with what he was then going to turn into, which would have been the Horton Dance Group. And so I was in this production within a very rapid period of time, unskilled, untutored, and in love. And the movement fit me as though it was of my own making.
One amazed critic wrote, "It had the energy of genius, no matter how far gone wrong." The most extraordinary work of that spectacular season, and the beginning of a lifelong obsession with the subject, was his first dance version of Salome, with Joy Montandon advertised by an imaginative producer as Joy Montoya of the Vieux Carré, formerly with the exotic Samarkand Ballet. It was performed on the stage of the Shrine Auditorium with 75 dancers for the Bacchanal.
Should I tell you about my bosoms? Well, I was not particularly well endowed at that time, and they felt that Herodias, which was the part I was playing, should be sort of tidged up. So Bill got a hold of a little Japanese rice bowl, and he put some clay over it and made the shape of this bosom. And then he did papier-mâché over that, and he made them both going toward Mecca, unfortunately. And then those were sewn onto the costume, or the costume was built over them, and so forth. And I was not aware of sticking out quite as far as I did, and I would brush by people and they would look at me because of these papier-mâché bosoms that were very hard and unyielding.
Horton said of his work at this time, "We are trying to create a dance expression that is truly American. We feel we're making progress, but the whole thing is in a state of evolvement. We constantly change. We've discarded what we did last year, even though we thought it good. Next year, we may retain little of this year's work. That's the way we grow."
Martha Graham's technique is based on a contraction and release. And Martha built her technique on her body, which means that you had to have a particular kind of instrument in order to become an authority in that. Lester, on the other hand, did his technique on his company so he could work with every kind of body, and therefore he could explore the anatomy more vigorously. And any kind of body can do the Horton technique.
In the winter of 35 and spring of 36, The Horton Dance Group did two concerts at the Figueroa Playhouse. The first was called The Mine.
And it was an extremely emotional, highly moving group of women around a mine shaft, waiting for word of a disaster in the mine. There was scarcely any movement, hardly anything you would really call dance, but he had evoked such an emotional form with what he did that I was very moved, and I simply never forgot it.
The second was Lysistrata, with Eleanor Brooks in the lead role.
He had a wonderful way of amalgamating movements so that a group of people seemed to be one, and it became very emotional. He was very dramatic in an undramatic way. And where some dancers try very hard for a dramatic effect, Lester just got it naturally. Naturally, he just handled people beautifully.
Another piece on that program, called Flight from Reality, was a series of satiric solos danced by Horton himself. One was called The Ivory Tower, another, Escape into the Exotic. He was already changing, criticizing himself, slipping away from the work he had just created, like a snake shedding its skin. There was a creative fire in him which cast endless shadows, and these shadows were like his masks. His friends and his dancers could easily mistake those shadows for himself.
I have never in my life, and I've been living a long time now, met another human being with the type of charisma that Lester had. He drew people, and drew people of from all of the arts and from all walks of life to him. There were people in there constantly because he was so compelling and so young all of his life, young and liberated.
Lester was a whole person. And he was in good balance. But very straightforward, very uncomplicated in the main, because his mind was always working on what was his raison d'etre. And it was wonderful to observe.
I think that in some ways, apparently, he was easily swayed, because he had some very strong dancers in his group with very positive ideas of their own. And I think that they were able to sway him, to convince him that their ideas were as good as his or whatever. And I think that he was not always his own man.
He was the only person I've ever known in my life who was amoral. And I was trying to reform him, which was, you know, I was like 18 trying to reform him. One incident. This was Horton Dance Group days. And in taking classes were, of course, all the kinds of people that Lester could attract to him. Everyone, lay people, artists, actors, whatever, would pour into Lester's studio. And there was this rather meek man, never to be noticed, really. One day he showed up and he stood in front of me like this and imitated everything I did. I was fairly young. I was terrified. I didn't know what was wrong with him. What was he doing? And the man had flipped out, was what he had done. And Lester, instead of sensing my terror and my need to have somebody take care of the man, I didn't want him to just go away. I wanted somebody to take hold of him and give him whatever it was. Lester laughed. Lester thought this was terribly, terribly funny. I never recovered from that part of Lester's attitude toward people. He didn't dislike people, ever. He welcomed them all the time, and they were attracted to him very, very strongly. But I don't think he had a nurturing sense about him.
I think he always hated the fact that he was gay. I think that he, in other words, I think he had a, what we call a self-loathing. I think he had a very bad image of himself. And so that he loved his sexuality. He loved the sensation and the feeling of it, but emotionally and intellectually, he despised himself. I think it had to do with an older man. He had these flashes, almost these flashes of insane fury at times. And I used to ask him who, I used to ask him for a name, and he would simply close down.
We were all touched by the same fire in Lester. I believe he loved us each through a different mask.
And yet he could be so sweet, so silly. Did you ever see the takeoff on Ruth St. Denis?
He used to not only do takes off of Miss Ruth, but he used to do absolutely execrable takes off of Ted.
Oh, really? Oh, wait, that I never saw. Or did I? I don't remember.
Probably not, because Ted apparently had some rather distorted ideas of sexuality with the young men in his own troupe. And so then Lester would do the takeoff of what was going on, you know. And they were pretty vicious at times, but there was also a fury there. Oh, there was something there too. Something very distorted, something very awful. I never thought of that, but that has to be something there.
Was he indifferent to the pain of that lunatic? How could a man who despised himself be so continually creative? Everyone saw him through the prism of their own character. Were they blinded by his charisma? Few knew his secrets, nor comprehended his burdens. By 1936, the fascists were building giant military machines, already bent on conquering the world. They had a sacred mission: to cleanse the world of inferior racial strains, to stamp humanity's face in their own image. And the modus operandi was mass murder. Working people all over the world began to wake up. The threat was to them, and it was becoming economic as well as military. To the working man, fascism and capitalism were twin faces of evil. The communists, who were in the vanguard of opposition, exalted the worker. Uncle Joe was their comrade, Uncle Sam's brother. Workers of the world, unite. But Horton's creative imagination held no allegiance to dogma. In his theater, egotism was meant to be dissolved in the search for something more elusive, mysterious, supra-rational, a unity beyond conflict. It was his dancers who were swept up in conflict.
Whenever we would get into some kind of political discussion, this was much, much later, he would kind of look toward the ceiling, and then he loved to whittle. He would make spoons and things.
The artists, dancers, and mask makers who had been his first students during his little theater of the Verdugo's days, and who were still part of the Horton dance group, were alienated by the new authoritarian tone of the collective.
Had asked some of us to do a program at a theater up on North Broadway for some kind of benefit that I was not enthusiastic about. And there were other people on the program, and I didn't care for them or being on a show with them or anything. I was being terribly snobbish and austere about the whole thing, and I was very annoyed about something, so I just picked up my makeup case and walked out before we went on. And that's how I left Lester, and of course I felt terrible. And I called him and apologized, but we were finished at that point, and that was the end of that. Then subsequently, we became very good friends again.
The Horton Dance Group had become a cell of militant anti-fascists, as was the group theater in New York, and hundreds of contemporary artistic communities across the land. Horton, who was never indifferent, merely watched and listened. Some belittled his detachment, thinking of him as a kind of idiot savant, unredeemed by their grassroots militancy.
I remember Lester during those House of Un-American activities saying, well, you know, I mean, there were certain elements in the theater, as I understood it, as a 19-year-old, who wanted him to declare himself, you know, stand up and say that you are this, that, and the other. He'd say, I don't need to stand up and say anything because I'm living what I'm doing.
Now both successful and notorious, the group expanded into a new and larger second-floor studio on Beverly Boulevard. Horton formed an auxiliary company and started a school, but he took no money for himself. He never seemed to be able to take money for himself. For the next decade, with Bill Bown, he shared a tiny room on the first floor of the studio, and Bill, the peacemaker, helped to maintain the precarious balance between Horton's creativity and his dancers' politics. It was Lewitsky's growing technical perfection that induced him to begin to codify his technique and to charge her with teaching it.
I couldn't stand being on the stage with people who couldn't dance. It drove me crazy. And so I was the one training them. You know, no, it's not your left foot, it's your right foot. No, you don't move that way. No, it's from the hip, not from the knees. I had spent my life training these dancers so that I could dance with dancers.
Joyce Trisler, in a dance magazine tribute to Horton, described the technique.
There were movements done on the floor and those done standing, but floor work included transitions to a standing position or to leaps in the air. The distinction between planes was ignored, so his elevation studies often included falls. Exercises for the feet and hands included every movable part. Those for the face included eyes, brows, mouth, and tongue. His pelvic studies derived from ethnic movements. Coordination problems were complex, often as many as 5 separate movements simultaneously. The technique produced no particular style. A Horton dancer could be identified by high extensions and limber back, fluidity of movement rather than by any mannerism.
In 1937, he presented a series of evening-long epic works with enormous casts, beginning with Stravinsky's Rite of Spring at the Hollywood Bowl, later restaged at UCLA's Royce Hall.
It was wonderful. He did it at the Hollywood Bowl, and it was just very extraordinary what he did. There have been many, many dance groups appear at the Hollywood Bowl, and they all seem to have a feeling that they must fill that huge stage with people, whereas actually one person on that huge stage is all that is really necessary. And Lester had a lot of people, which he used very advantageously, because he would have 1 or 2 people on the stage and then have a lot of people. And you got the effect that he was after. But his entire primitive working of the sacra was very wonderful. That was an extraordinary performance.
Another epic followed, Chronicle, in which he interpreted the American experience from its colonial origins to the present, from the point of view of the oppressed. In that work, Eleanor Brooks's lyricism complemented Lewitsky's physical control. And finally, he created his second and third versions of Salome, this time for Bela Lewitsky, who was a sensation. Following summer, while teaching a workshop at Mills College in Oakland, he staged Conquest, a story of Mexico embodied in the conflict between Spanish and Aztec cultures. These fragments were captured on 8mm film by a teacher at the college. The Horton Dance Group was now the most important and controversial ensemble on the West Coast. Horton met with the famous impresario, Sol Hurok, who tried to arrange a New York concert, a European tour, exposure to the world. But it was not meant to be. Too many financial constraints, traveling with such a large company, such epic works. Back in L.A., despite or because of his disappointment, he created a light-hearted satirical review called Something to Please Everybody. Fun dances, marking time. Audiences loved it. The year was 1939.
I had a small birthday party for him. I had at that time a beautiful home my husband and I had built on top of a hill, had a gorgeous view of the city. And I had this party for him. And we had a very large living room. We pushed back the rugs and everybody was happily doing square dancing, and Lester was doing the calling for the square dancing. We were having a great deal of fun. For some reason, somebody turned on the radio just as the announcement came across that Hitler had marched into Poland, I think you said it was, or wherever it was. Anyway, it was his first move that led to the war, and it simply brought the party to a dead end.
Suddenly they were in a world war, and his dancers, under wartime constraints, began to come and go. Many of the men got drafted. Barely able to hold his company together, he was watching 10 years of creative labor go up in the smoke of world conflict.
After the Horton Dance Group, Lester, who had been earning his living, fortunately, in films, had a tendency to turn quite commercial, because he could succeed at that with some kind of salary. And many of us were employed in filmmaking with him.
The next year, though he choreographed the dance sequences for 3 more movies, he was still just marking time, presiding over the remnants of the Horton Dance Group. Then he got an offer to perform at the opening of a lavish Manhattan nightclub, the Folies Bergère. It was a review, not a venue for concert dancers, but it was New York, and money. It might just hold his group together.
I hated every moment of it. I can't stand nightclub work. So, you know, you're competing with glasses, with showgirls, with who knows what, and I'm not good at that.
So after 10 years, they finally appeared in New York. The serious critics ignored them, and at the end of the run, the unhappy company disbanded, went their separate ways. Horton and Lewitsky came back to the Beverly Boulevard studio and resumed teaching. He did another film, but he was at sea, rudderless for the first time in his life. Then New York beckoned again.
And his only proviso at that time, he came to tell me this, was that he could form this other company with money backing him only on one condition, if I was not permitted to go along. So, you know, for... it's a company that was built around Sonia Shaw and funded by her husband. And she was not about to have any Lewitsky competition near her. So, although it was a little painful, I could understand it and thought it was, you know, probably fortunate that Lester could continue his work with some support.
They had been together for 10 years. She had matured under his aegis into a great and powerful dancer. How could she not have been deeply wounded? For a lesser dancer to come between them, to buy Lester with money, was this his weakness or a measure of his necessity? In any case, it didn't work. The company fell apart, and Horton returned to California. Lewitsky had moved to Chicago to be with her husband, Newell Reynolds. By that time, the landlord had sold the Beverly Boulevard studio. Horton went back to the desert. He bought a house with Bill Bowne.
We lived in Chatsworth. And that time, Chatsworth
was the ends of the earth.
Nobody lived in Chatsworth, and he lived, you know, in the hole in a mountain, you know, carved out. And they had all these snakes that were their pets. Yes.
He had snakes?
Millions of snakes, and he loved snakes, and he taught us all to like snakes. You know, snakes were very love warmth, and they'd curl around you, and he slept with them. I mean, it was all a new world.
Right. He continued choreographing movie Exotica. Then Sonia Shaw's husband invited him to New York again, this time to choreograph his Broadway-bound musical about Billy the Kid.
I went east because Newell was in the service, and so we were able to stop by and see this company at work and to see the show he did called Shootin' Star, which was not at all successful, but he did wonderful work in it. Lester's choreography for it was, I thought, quite splendid.
Back in Chatsworth, still without a company, he wrote to Lewitsky about becoming his partner and building their own theater.
I got a letter from him. Would you like to form another company? Would I join him in this? And I, innocent, it was in a way a measure of my both innocence and lack of understanding of Lester. I was too young. I said, yes, if we can have trained dancers, and not 50, maybe 6 good dancers. And could you pay them just $5? Because we never got paid. Yes, 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 all of this would happen. Of course, all of this never happened.
So he began all over again, with no money, as usual.
The stage, as I recall, was built out of all war surplus materials. We were able to find these very, actually, it was very difficult at this time, just after the war, to buy lumber even. So we got war surplus lumber, and we devised a method of springing the floor by buying aircraft hoses. They were so long and about this big around, and we snipped them down one side, opened them up, and put them on the underside of the...
well, that's something you've never lost.
Audacity. Anyway, and all these other dancers, Bella and all the others, were hissing me all the way down, saying, that's not a hip turn, you know, didn't you watch to see? And I came up to the very end of the thing, this did Lester, and he looked at me and he said, you're a lyrical dancer. You're in.
In between rehearsals, members of the new company would see their leader standing in front of his unfinished theater, chatting with any passerby who might express an interest in what was going on inside, encouraging them to come to the performance.
We worked the night before the opening for about 16 straight hours to get these seats all in order. Fortunately, we made it just in time. We had just finished the last row and people were clawing their way to get in.
Shy, languid Carmen de Lavallade came all the way from South Central Los Angeles, Jefferson High.
And I was privy to see the beginnings or the workings of Totem Incantation. Lester was working with Herman Boden and Bell on Beloved, somewhere in there, Salome. And I got to play in the percussion orchestra. And I had a pot of all that. I remember I was sitting under these big drums with a can of screws or a pot full of screws, and I had a rattle on a zither, and we're counting these. It was just wild.
I had no idea of becoming a choreographer when I first came to the Horton School. I came to the Horton School because Carmen was coming to the Horton School, and we were coming to the same, going to the same high school, Jefferson High School at the time. And I had seen her dance in the school auditorium on point to Mozart, and got to know her. She said that she went out to a modern dance studio in Hollywood. So I came with her, and I was immediately impressed by what it was. I sat in the back of the studio for about 6 months, watching Lester play this exotic array of instruments while the class took place, while people did these death-defying feats. And finally, Lester himself came to me and said, you know, are you going to be, how long are you going to sit in the back? Don't you want to come in the back and take a class? You know, while Carmen's taking a class here, then you could take the class in the back room, and I did that.
The season opened with Totem Incantation, about the transformation of a boy into an eagle. This was Horton's tribute to his origins. After that came...
Behold, thou art fair. Thou hast dove's eyes within thy locks. The smell of thy garments is like unto the smell of Lebanon. Honey and milk are under thy tongue. Set me as a seal upon thine heart, for love is strong as death.
Turned my life around, changed the whole direction of my life. It was incredible. Bela Lewitsky was incandescent, incredible. And I remember jumping up to my feet at the conclusion, at intermission, screaming bravo, and my hands were stinging from applause.
I just sit there for hours watching the process. And I remember being that it's a duet, you know, and I remember it came from a newspaper article about that religious man who beat his wife to death with the Bible and all that. And I remember once they had this discussion about was she an adulteress or not? And Lester wouldn't say yes and he wouldn't say no.
To them?
To them. He said, it's up to you to decide.
When I was 11, I saw the company perform Salome, and that cast included Louisa Krech, who played Herodias, Bela Lewitsky as Salome.
Herself.
Carl Radcliffe was the guard, Herman Boden was the king, and Rudy Gernreich was the eunuch. To be
The very famous designer.
And it was something at 11, pre-puberty, a situation of such incredible power and beauty, and the everything about that performance, that production, was so meshed in terms of a piece of theater that I couldn't move out of my seat. And my mother said, "Oh, that was very nice, wasn't it?" And I said, "I'm going to do that."
Well, he was a man who was always doing things, as you said a little bit earlier. I mean, he was always alive. I mean, he was painting, he was designing, he was choreographing, he was composing. He was showing you what the smallest bee was about en route to, you know, to Ojai. He was taking us to Japanese and Chinese restaurants and showing us what Japanese food was about in 1952. Right. You remember that?
Oh.
I mean, I never knew anything about sushi or tempura, but Lester would take us to the Japanese restaurants and say, "This is this and this and this, and they eat this and why," and all of that. I mean, all of that was so wonderful. It all just came in. It opened me. It opened so many people too. You know, to their perceptions of themselves, I think they never would have had without this wonderful, wonderful man.
The atmosphere had in it, you know, this incredible creative energy. There wasn't anybody who wasn't part of the theater group, the adults, who wasn't involved in making masks or painting the floor or doing curtains or ironing something and making costumes. I mean, there was this activity that I, you know, at this great distance of being the a visiting student coming in for class, would observe. And there was such a cooperation towards the next production that one had a sense that what it took to make something happen on the stage, and one was beginning to glimpse the pieces, the fragments that go into making any production of any kind, and everybody was involved. And
he just presented it all. I mean, the theater to me was a magical world. I mean, the instruments and the color and the shapes and the mobiles and the music that he played while we were scrubbing the stage. One piece of which I remember was Samuel Barber's Knoxville Summer of 1915, which I immediately choreographed when I got to New York City about 1960. The trips to the fabric store with him to buy fabric was a lesson in costume design, changing the gels during the performances, being on top in the wings and putting down bubbles during Another Touch of Clay, having him make you up the first time you gave the performance, helping him in the scene doc with his arms and elbow deep in paint was the experience. I mean. And the experience of the way he felt about himself and about you as you were growing as an artist, which I didn't realize.
No.
But I mean, no, he didn't say, "Alvin, you must do this and you must do that." He just presented this whole thing, and then it kind of came into the, it seeped into your pores.
Right.
Yeah. No, he didn't push, but he offered. He was there.
That next season, 1949, I saw Bella in Warsaw Ghetto with Sandra Orens, and In the Park, which was based on that Sleepy Lagoon case where a cop murdered a Pachuco kid in cold blood. And I remember seeing Connie and Jenny in The Bench of the Lamb, and A Touch of Clay in Delightful Two with Rudy Carl and Louisa Creck.
When you were trying out for the company, you don't remember, do you remember? And we were all sitting behind that desk looking very, you know.
No, it was to get a scholarship.
That's right, for the scholarship.
For the children. Thing.
And I remember you getting up, and I remember turning to Lester and saying, "She's a lyrical dancer. She has to be in."
I mean, how did the selection of you being in Jenny Bench of the Land, I mean, how did that come about? Lester decided
he was going to do a ballet for me.
For you.
Yeah.
How did that feel?
Oh, are you kidding? I mean, I can still feel it, you know, it brings tears to my eyes. Besides, made me completely, utterly hysterical because I was, you know, immediately I knew I couldn't do it, you know. And so I set about just killing myself trying to do it. And he gave me all sorts of things to do that I had never done before and that were very difficult for me. I have this fear of height. So the two ballets I'm in is Touch of Clay, where I'm on the swing and I have to jump from swing to swing. And there's that other girl there. What was her name, the one who died?
Louisa Creck.
Louisa Creck, who isn't afraid of height at all. She's jumping from hanging onto the swings and jumping. And I'm, you know, shitless, you know, like poop all the time in my pants.
Frank Eng, at that time a critic for the Daily News, volunteered his services as a press agent. Horton was tired of doing works of social significance. He wanted to focus on his lighter side, and Frank Eng, to Lewitsky's dismay, supported him. Bill, the peacemaker, who left to get married that year, said, "I thought it was a disintegration. So Bella and I withdrew every kind of approval. But now when I see what the sexual liberation thing is like, I realize he was doing what he always did, anticipating what was about to happen. To us, it seemed he had a tremendous social statement to make. Instead, he was doing those things. But it was a social statement, and it's had its effect on the whole country, the whole world." Larry Warren, in his biography of Lester, suggested a further reason for conflict. Horton's teaching, he said, was intuitive, and he felt Bella was becoming too precise, careful, and balletic. He wished to train artists. It seemed to him she was only interested in building technicians.
I remember Lester telling me that he wanted to... he had a choreography called the Cottonwood Leaves Are Whispering, and it was he had intended it to be a dance drama about the contest between a Caucasian, a white cowboy, and a Mexican cowboy over the favors of a prostitute. And I understand that Bella objected to the raciness of the theme.
I was just 13. I had a scholarship. I was oblivious to the conflicts of the grown-ups. All I knew was that one day I was going to dance Salome.
Choreo 50 opened with Estío de Ti, a four-dance suite with a Latin American flavor, similar to his 30s review, Something to Please Everybody. And the main work, A Bouquet for Molly, was Cottonwood Leaves transformed into what some thought of as almost musical comedy. Lewitsky's discontent finally erupted. With her husband, she confronted Horton. She wanted out. A meeting was arranged to discuss the terms of separation.
I'll never forget this meeting as long as I live, because Bill wasn't there, and I felt that was wrong because he was a full partner. And Mo Orens was there, sort of, well, as a mediator. And Bella Newell had an attorney. I can't remember the guy's name. But throughout this whole meeting, Lester didn't say one word. And I sat in a row right in front of him, and I looked at him frequently, and his face just progressively, you know, got ashen and gray. He never said one word.
Horton got the theater. Lewitsky and Reynolds got a cash settlement, a pittance compared to what they'd given. But everyone knew there was no money. Company members took sides. Some joined Lewitsky's new school, Dance Associates.
I remember the dressing rooms were filled with gossip and innuendo. Parents were warned in whispers that dance theater was not a place for children.
I must have been such a plague to Lester. I wonder that he didn't rejoice when I left, because I undertook a strange role in relation to Lester, very much younger than him, very much, very much more inexperienced than Lester. I was a moralist, and Lester was not a moralist, to put it kindly. And so we were on different wavelengths. I loved him very, very much, and I think he loved me. I would just take that for granted. But we came of very different backgrounds with very different basis of lifestyles, so that we separated on these issues. And I I think I stepped into places in Lester's life that I had no right to be at all. And I was very judgmental. So that must have been very hard on him.
Horton looked like a man whose house had been destroyed.
The first week, we were supposed to be left with $1,000 operating capital in the bank, and we were $1,200 overdrawn. Every check bounced. I sat at the desk and I cried. I didn't know what to do. And I told Lester, throw it into court, you know, and he said, no, we'll make it up with this week's tuitions. We'll cover the checks. We'll be okay. Forget it. He told me he wanted to revive Salome with Carmen, and I looked at that child in class. I thought, God, are you joking? You know, I didn't tell him, say that she couldn't do it, but I was very skeptical and doubtful. That gawky little kid, Salome, you know, he didn't say anything. And then, of course, on opening night, I didn't believe that this vacuous little high school girl, you know, God, she read the hell out of the role. And I was properly impressed. And from that point on, you know, I when Lester said he was going to cast somebody in something, well, I figured he knew. I sure didn't.
When I took over from Belle with the Salome, I don't know if it has anything to do with what we're saying, but he said, I have to change this because that's not going to fit your body. What you can't do what Bella can do, and Bella can't do what you can do. You're too different, because we were two totally different bodies. Certain things fit. There were certain moves that anybody can do, but there were other moves that just didn't fit, didn't work. So he changed that. And that way it made you feel like, oh, it didn't matter that you couldn't do what Bella did, because you can do what you can do.
He choreographed two more pieces for Carmen that summer, then collapsed, a heart attack. But no one knew, because Eng kept it secret, said it was a minor illness. He got members of the company to take over Horton's classes while he recuperated in Chatsworth. When he came back, he moved into the sewing room with Eng to save money, as usual. He was going to take it easy, do more fun dances, forget about social statements. But he seemed so much older. That year, Lewitsky was called to testify about her radical associations. They say she spoke only one sentence. Gentlemen, I am a dancer, not a singer. When Eng told Horton there was a gray list, that they could get their names removed from it by a few simple admissions, Horton just turned around, walked out, and slammed the door. He started again. Misai, Joyce, and Lelia joined Vita Solomon, Carmen, Jimmy, Jack Dodds, Audrey Covington, and Ellie Johnson, who would dance with Catherine Dunham, and Restless Alvin, who kept coming and going. A new company, the Kidlets. It would be his last.
Out of all of his companies, he was always had relatively young people performing way beyond their years and experience. Now, how did he do that? And for years, I tried to understand that for myself.
He always allowed you to grow because he was always growing himself. Because he's never stagnant. I mean, your technique or whatever you were doing this year might be one thing. Next year, it's going to be something else. You never knew what he was going to do. And he was never one of those people that said, it has to be this way, it has to be that way. Constantly evolving. So we were always very courageous in the fact that you take on anything. You know, nothing was stagnant. Right. You were never stagnant. You were constantly growing. And you were always very open, because he was always very open. He made you open.
What he was able to do was to speak to each individual in a language that they could understand at the deepest part of themselves. It was almost as though he spoke to your soul, your essence.
Choreo 51 opened with Frevo, a Rio carnival dance, Batucada, a Brazilian work dance, Cumbia, a Panamanian erotic duet, Kathak from North India, Huibap, a Burmese takeoff, and the abstract, magical, another touch of Klee to the music of Stan Kenton. For Horton, it must have seemed like that spectacular 1934 season all over again. That summer, he choreographed Medea for Carmen at Ojai, a study of betrayal and unspeakable revenge. Perhaps it was the only way he could express his pain. He certainly revealed it to no one at the theater, though it was visible to those who had eyes to see. Joyce Trisler, in her Dance Magazine interview, described his appearance.
He was shabbily dressed. His eyes were sunken and looked as if they would fill with tears at any moment. But his rehearsals were uncompromising. We rehearsed fully, hours at a time. When allowed to rest, we'd fling ourselves on the floor and put our feet up on the side of the stage. I remember lying there, my heart beating in my throat, thinking, this man is going to kill me.
Working with Carmen, Joyce, Misai, Jimmy, Lelia, and others, he began a final codification of the technique he had developed in collaboration with three generations of dancers over a period of 20 years. It is now part of the vocabulary of modern dance.
Lester is a very respected man throughout the world. I mean, the technique, you know, it emanates from our school in New York. I mean, we were trained by Jimmy Truitt and by George Trisler, the teachers at the school. And but in France, in Germany, in Tokyo, and God knows everywhere, the Lester Horton technique is being taught.
To raise money for Choreo 52, Horton organized a costume ball, the Bal Karib, which became an annual event, later held at Earl Carroll's and the Hollywood Palladium. He met Duke Ellington that year. It wasn't his way to announce a new work, but his dancers would know something was happening when he started introducing new movement combinations into their technique class. They found themselves working on Liberian Suite. that same year, he touched the very heart of tragedy with Prado de Peña, The Meadow of Pain. Based on Garcia Lorca's play, Yerma, it was the story of an unfulfilled marriage. Carmen danced the lead role. Carmelita Maracci, a great dancer whose austerity was legend, was so moved by it that she arranged to get them booking in New York for the following spring.
It was in gray with just handkerchiefs of the most brilliant, wonderful Kelly green and brilliant red and orange, or fans or something. There was just these notes of color in this kind of gray background and a couple of chairs. And it was absolutely marvelous. It was so powerful. I don't think I've ever seen a ballet that was more powerful. And you felt what she was going through. I can still feel it. You know, it's one of those things that I will carry to the grave, probably.
In March of 53, Horton choreographed a series of dedications in our time to Ruth Marion Martha, Memorial to Hiroshima, and to Jose Clemente Orozco, among others. They opened at the Wilshire Rebell, hoping to raise cash for New York.
I was so terrified of Orozco. This is a particular, this is the hardest dance in the world. A pas-de-deux based on this Mexican painter, which with very strenuous movements, with the biggest movements of the Horton technique. I mean, laterals into T-turns, into falls, into van jumps. I mean, this is the biggest male vocabulary in the modern dance world. You know, and I just didn't feel adequate to do it. But it was dancing with Carmen.
Right.
So I forced myself.
We left early in the spring. There were 12 of us in two station wagons. One of them had the Prado de Peña set tied on top. We were a noisy, interracial crew of vagabonds, Lester's kidlets, packed like sardines, traveling 6 days and nights across the continent with our maestro. He was tilting once again toward Mecca. We managed a boat ride once around the Statue of Liberty before opening at the YMHA on 92nd Street. Saturday night and a Sunday matinee.
About 500 New Yorkers saw them, most of them probably dancers. Ted Shawn invited them to Jacob's Pillow, but Horton couldn't afford to keep them in town long enough to wait for reviews. He had to wire his agent, Jesse Kohlberg, for a $300 loan to get them home. She generously sent $600. Many who missed that concert were nevertheless aware that an event had taken place. They knew they had missed something of real consequence. John Martin of the New York Times wrote in his preface to Larry Warren's biography, "During his life, Horton's work was virtually unknown east of Pasadena. We were turning cartwheels over Graham and Humphrey. altogether unaware that somebody was breaking similar ground on the West Coast and with comparable revolutionary results. Clive Barnes' assessment of Lester years after his death was painfully ironic.
I was in the 11th grade at Hollywood High, falling asleep in my classes because I was working 7 to 10 hours a day at dance theater. A principal now, I was invited to lunch with the maestro, and he said he wanted me to learn Salome to alternate with Carmen. Salome, the role which had drawn me to the theater. And he told me he was going to create a new ballet, especially for me, a dedication to Saint Joan. I threw myself into the Bal Caribe, which was now the costume event in the city. I felt like I was walking on air.
Although it helped finance Choreo 53, the Bal Caribe wasn't enough to pay their way back to New York, so Eng divided the company into commercial and concert units. Several dancers ended up in both groups. They got an engagement at Ciro's, which wanted to divide them even further along ethnic lines, but Horton, as usual, refused. Ciro's took a gamble, booked them for a week.
We hated it. Joyce and I were Lester's kidlets. I was going to start rehearsing Joan of Arc, and here we were dancing in a nightclub, front row drunks groping for our legs. I retaliated, started dropping hot candle wax on them, and we complained to Lester.
Do you remember the night I came back after, you know, I usually came in after work at midnight, 12:30, and the second show, you know, and you and Joyce were screaming at Lester on the sidewalk in the stage door behind Ciro's, and the customers were coming out. And I grabbed you both by the scuff of the neck, and we all went back to the theater and had a meeting. How dare you? You know, Lester was, he was dying then. But I knew it, but I couldn't face it. I couldn't consciously face it.
Bill Bowne and Lester's friend, photographer Constantine Hasselevers, both told me before they passed on that it wasn't so much that Lester felt he was dying, but that he felt trapped, still reaching toward New York, which had at last nodded kindly to him. He was exhausted, no longer wanted to please anybody. He wanted to change his life, to start all over again, and to do so, he had to wipe the slate clean.
The day Lester died, he was supposed to start choreographing Saint Joan. And I was standing at the theater. That was going to be my first ballet.
Yeah. But he make Ruth Mary and Martha?
He did.
And
he did.
Other pieces
but
on you?
That was, this, that was,
this was the real expression of yourself.
That was going to be my piece, you know, for me, in a sense. And I stood at the theater and cursed him because he wasn't there, and I was standing there waiting to get in. And how could he do, I mean,
how could you do
call that? The house, call, you know, call everybody up, where was he? And then eventually I went home, and we were performing at Ciro's at the time. And eventually somebody called me up and said that Lester had died that morning.
Now this black and white photograph is all that's left of our dance theater. Yet it remains a temple in our imagination, paid for by Lester with his life. We held together without him for a few years, but the spell was broken, our unity gone. Alvin and Carmen went to New York to dance in Truman Capote's House of Flowers. Carmen has since become a treasure of American dance, and the world knows what Alvin has done. I met John Cassavetes, and we made his first film, Shadows, together. Joyce joined the Doris Humphrey Company and later became its artistic director. Jimmy taught the Horton technique to the Alvin Ailey Company, later in academia, and it has spread worldwide. Rudy was already becoming a world-famous fashion designer. Bella, of course, is now the doyenne of West Coast dance. So many others have carried Lester's spirit all across America, all over the world. We were originals, all of us, because our teacher made us so.
We virtually have no form. We're seeking one, and we don't have it. And if he were with us today, I believe that we would move more quickly into the new plane, which I think might be representational so that we could understand without conflict.
It was a very large gift and a rare one, because the fact that we still feel it to be so palpable and we feel so indebted to it speaks for the fact that no other influence came in that measures up to that.
I think that when you talk about Graham and Humphrey and Charles Wideman, people like that, I think Horton's name should be right there.
Lester personified the fury, the sort of chained fury of Prometheus in dance. And I had the feeling that that's who he was, that he was Prometheus waiting to break the chains.
"You understand," he said to me, almost without moving his lips. And that was his way, to see what was inside you, then teach you how to embrace it all. "I do understand. How you could so love the aesthetic of motion and gesture in this theater of humanity that you could give your life to it. Isn't that why we all loved you so? Why we thought of you as our teacher and our father? The doors may be closed forever. Your theatrical imagination gone. But the technique lives.